There are many interests to be balanced. So when you look at a code, ultimately it must be doable. And if you are in a situation where the Reserve Bank has not changed its policy on acquisition finance, then to put a stakeholder who sort of just managed to reach 25% to trigger a 100% offer, where there is an incumbent promoter sitting in who may not want to really sell, you are actually putting out escrow funds which are not going to be really used. So there is a financing cost which is unnecessary. And as I mentioned today, there is a mismatch between the delisting regulations which SEBI has and the draft bill, the draft takeover code. The reason being that in the current law, 75% is the maximum that a promoter can hold, because a minimum public holding of 25% is required for continued listing. If you're going to do a 100% offer at a fixed price, it contrasts with the requirement of the delisting regulation, where anything above 75 with the intention to delist must be on a Swiss auction basis, which is based therefore on the maximum tender and the price of the maximum block which is tendered, and which is therefore at variance with the takeover code 100%. So you would have two regimes applicable for the same situation, because once you cross the threshold of 90, the company is entitled to do this. So therefore, what will be the, there will be smart speculators in the market. What will they do? They will pick up 10%, corner 10% and one share. So inherently the offer is dead, because you can't delist. You reach 89.99, and therefore the offer has to revert back to 75. So the person who picked up shares effectively from 75 to 89, which is almost 14%, has to unravel that on the market at the Swiss auction price. I mean at the price which market will fall. Not the Swiss auction price, but the offer price. That's unfair. So I think when they looked at it in entirety, and there's not a single known instance of a 100% offer succeeding in India. Even delisting offers have failed because people sit in this corner and, you know, block the 90% threshold. So this is something which the regulator needed to see in the context of experience. And the experience shows that 100% offers in the Indian context just don't happen, because we are not a very deep market and there is cornering still. So that's why I think when you look at it in as a composite, it may be unfair, but it's a phase, as you know, some experts have spoken, that this will be considered as phase one, because this is moving to a 51% block. So you are effectively paying for a control price, which is itself a higher price than normal. Because if it was 20%, it need not be control price. But 26 plus 25, which means that you can potentially reach 51, would mean that you have to really offer a control premium. I think there's been a consistent view that it is when either it is a share, and share here means equity share, because preference shares were always excluded from the takeover code, and even GDRs were originally excluded or continue to remain excluded except when they are voting rights. And I think consistently now Ministry of Corporate Affairs and the regulators are insisting on GDRs without voting rights. So the share definition under the takeover code contemplates shares or voting rights. So voting rights are also treated as shares. Now if you take a convertible debenture, or you take a convertible preference share, or you take any instrument which is convertible, it does not have voting rights in the equity class. And therefore they don't fall per se within the takeover code. And if they don't fall per se within the takeover code, the conversion event actually results in the trigger. So if I unravel the instrument and sort of get out of the instrument and become a share, at that time the thresholds will be looked at. So have I exceeded 5% pre-premium? Have I exceeded the 15% norm as per the current code? Now it goes 25. But that context is when I become a share, not before. So I don't see the regime of convertibles actually getting dragged into the takeover. See, mergers is a different concept and acquisition is a different concept. What has been interfered with is acquisition of shares. No one has really gone into the merger doctrine, where effectively one company merges into another company it amalgamates, either a new company comes into existence or assets are triangulated. That is not really yet in dispute. What has got into the tangle is this whole context where, because of the Mauritius Treaty and the Andolan Bachao judgment of the Supreme Court, they had held the principle that a global license once the residency test is satisfied, you don't need to go behind that. What has happened in Vodafone and what has happened in the Birla AT&T, Birla Nuovo judgment, is that notwithstanding the judgment of the Supreme Court, they have gone on the documents of joint venture or the theory of effects theory. See, in the case of Vodafone, Mauritius was not an issue. It was a Cayman Island, BVI Island kind of story. So there was no tax treaty as between those territories and India. So any transfer made in those jurisdictions did not have the benefit of a tax exemption. But the argument which was contended, it's an offshore transaction between two non-residents, why should Indian taxation look at it? Whereas the Indian tax authority said, no, sorry gentlemen, this has dealings with an Indian asset. Your acquisition documents clearly show that you're talking of Indian control, Indian joint ventures, everything which is actually having a nexus with India. And therefore, Indian taxation principles should be attractive because your entire valuation is based on Indian market or how you are really doing the business in India. With all that circumstantial evidence, they are saying that even if it's a non-resident to non-resident transfer, it is really to deal with an Indian vehicle. And therefore, we are going to exercise our jurisdiction over that. Now, then they took it one level above, that because it has dealings with a capital asset of India, you owe the duty of withholding tax. Vodafone was the buyer, the seller was Hutchinson. Hutchinson didn't violate the law, but you violated the law because if it had an Indian nexus, you owed the duty to withhold the tax, which was a withholding tax applicable to capital gains. You failed to do so, therefore we are now penalizing it. And that's how the whole 12,000 crore claim has been raised on Vodafone. So that was the first bit. The second bit, which is even more serious, is that where they have actually said that this amounts to treaty shopping in a sense. If you are an American company, you use the vehicle of a Mauritius company, but all your brain, all your decision making, the entire process is American based. If you had to capitalize, you spend money from America into Mauritius and Mauritius got it into India. When you sold, again the money has gone back to US. So effectively, you're a US corporation hiding behind the Mauritius vehicle. And this is just a matter of form, not of substance. We are going to see the substance of the transaction. And since the substance shows that this is an American seller, we will go on the American treaty structure where there is no withholding tax exemption. And therefore, you as Indians, you failed in your duty in withholding tax. He got his price without looking at the withholding tax issue. And therefore, this violates the law. And therefore, we'll now punish you. Tata will punish you. This is the second step. That's how it's happened. That's how the reasoning has come. So, see, I don't think that's fair. The incidents of a share are not separate property. You know, the fact that you have a voting right, the fact that you have a director's right, the fact that you have a joint venture right is not a separate property from the share. Because those rights get embedded in the articles, therefore they are incidents of the share. I think perhaps there is an argument which is probably not considered, that you can't consider sub-elements of a share as a separate property. What may perhaps be a tenable argument is that you were used as a permitted transfer. That's the way the reasoning of the court has gone. And therefore you were a nominee of the real beneficiary, namely the US vehicle. And therefore it was a US tax issue. So the reasoning is not, these are indicators that the true rights were vesting with the holder of the Mauritius vehicle. The holding company was a US vehicle, Mauritius was a subsidiary was investing in India. So they go back to the theory that notwithstanding the corporate doctrine, in a sense it is like tearing the corporate book. They have, if you were to give it in a company law sense, they have torn the veil because they believe this is a tax avoidance. And that is a well-known exception in the field of separate legal personalities. So normally you could only look at Mauritius, you should not go behind Mauritius. But if there is a tax avoidance, there are well settled case law, even in company law that you can tear away. So they have torn the road. What I explained was that when the Competition Act was drafted and made law in 2002, Section 48 was part of that law. And what does the law says? That if you are a company, offences by the company extend to the directors who are in management and extend to even independent directors if there is neglect. The basic doctrine means that you should not engage in anti-competitive behavior, you should not abuse your governance, and you should not cause combinations which have appreciable adverse effects. These are the three crux. The crux of the competition law deals with these three concepts. So if you are in a combine or if you are in a company which abuses its dominant position or which sort of, you know, engages in anti-competitive behavior or contracts or agreements or does a combination which violates the principles of competition, then the liability is not merely that of the corporation. The liability is coextensive with directors in management. Because when you are a whole-time director, you are supposed to look and you are, there is, it's an artificial personality. So the principles really extend to officers in default or people who are in management on the same concept as prevails in company law. So they have extended that context even in competition law, that we can fine the company, but equally it is an offense of the individuals who are people in management. And they have extended it to independent directors who owe a duty to keep the company on the right path. And if they find that there was going to be some wrong, and if they neglected to inform the company, stop this, then they could also be part of the liability process. So there's a variation from the general doctrine that independent directors are not liable like people in management by Section 48. And that's not really been understood by industry. It has come into sharp focus now because the government, the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, has brought out a code for independent directors. One of the issues there is specifically relating to anti-competitive behavior. So the directors who are independent directors have been given a duty to watch out for anti-competitive behavior. So this is now dovetailing both from the company law as duties of independent directors and the Competition Act. So it's bound to now receive the seriousness of attention that had been missed so far. That's what I meant. The fact that the Competition Act is severe is well known because if it's 10% turnover penalty, then it is a serious law. No person can afford to fool around with it. Because this act has the maximum penalty in any law as far as India is concerned. Turnover is different from just assets. You're really talking of linkage with turnover. That's why you've seen damages like 800 million, billions have been granted against Microsoft, against several major bulk players. So it's not unusual to know that penalties in anti-competitive behavior is significant. The fact that it can extend to directors has not received the attention that it should, because people have been focusing on Section 3, 4, 5, 6 and not so much the subsidiary section. But when you sort of highlighted because of the new code which has come in, that's when you start looking at the whole law. Is there a liability? And you find it's there.